Music is a human universal. Researchers have found evidence of music in every single culture that has ever existed, dating right back to the beginning of civilization. We know music as a powerful and mysterious art form. The right song can give us the chills or induce intense, complex emotions. A single melody can send us back into the past, bringing up forgotten memories. We bond with one another through the music we share. How is music processed in our brains? Researchers and philosophers have been asking this question for centuries, but it wasn't until the development of modern brain imaging technology in the 1990s that researchers were able to witness in real time the effect that music has on your brain. These tools can show us the localized activation of the brain, what areas are activated and what areas are not when listening to music. Today, we are finally able to glimpse at how music, this complex, multidimensional art form, is processed in your brain. Follow along as we explore the path music takes from vibrations in the air to magic in your mind. We'll start at the source of all sound, sound waves. Sound waves are made up of oscillating patterns of high and low pressure air molecules. When an object moves or vibrates, it physically displaces the air around it, causing these vibrations in air molecules. Sound is movement. A sound wave has a number of properties that correspond to the different elements of sound that we hear. The number of times it oscillates per second is its frequency. This is responsible for the pitch that we hear. The magnitude of a sound wave, how much it's physically compressed in a single oscillation, is its amplitude. This plays a large part in the loudness that we hear. Sounds in the real world are not limited to a single frequency. They often contain a base frequency called the fundamental frequency, and a number of overlapping frequencies called the overtones or harmonics. These overtones are largely responsible for the timbre or tone of a sound. The timing of a sound is important as well. This is responsible for our experience of rhythm in music. The reverberation quality of a sound helps us determine how far away a sound is. We can tell when someone is talking close to us to our left or far away from us to our right. The slight microsecond difference it takes for a sound to reach our left ear versus our right is enough for our brains to determine where that sound is in space. Sound waves travel through our ears, strike the eardrum, and are carried through the ossicles to the cochlea. Vibrations in the fluid of the cochlea trigger hair cells that send electrical signals down the length of the auditory nerve. Different properties of sound affect these hair cells in different ways. Specific frequencies of sound waves will trigger specific locations of hair cells in the cochlea. Higher frequency sounds will trigger hair cells at the base of the cone-shaped cochlea, while lower frequency sounds will trigger hair cells at the apex. A sound wave with a higher amplitude will increase the firing rate of these hair cells and increase the activation bandwidth, which we perceive as a louder sound. The frequencies of overtones also trigger different locations of hair cells along the cochlea, causing a complex electrical pattern to be sent down the auditory nerve. The brain calculates the pitch that we perceive from this electrical pattern. Let's take a look at what happens when the auditory signal reaches your brain. The auditory nerve sends the auditory signal to the cochlear nuclei at the base of the brainstem. It is here that we begin to unconsciously process some aspects of sound, including pitch, loudness, and harmonic profile. At this point, the signal splits apart and takes different pathways up the brainstem. Sound timing and localization begin processing in the superior olivary complex. The sound signal consolidates in the inferior colliculus, reaches the medial geniculate nucleus on the thalamus, and is sent to the auditory cortex. The auditory cortex is where your conscious perception of sound begins. It is located on the superior side of your temporal lobe, hidden deep within the sylvian fissure. Its structure contains a core area, which is primarily responsible for raw sound data processing, and belt areas, which form connections to other areas of the brain. Different areas of the auditory cortex are responsible for its many functions, processing pitch, loudness, harmony, consonants and dissonance, sound localization, changes in frequency, and what is called auditory scene analysis. Imagine you're sitting in a busy cafe with your friend who's talking. Auditory scene analysis is your ability to pick out the auditory object, their voice, from the auditory scene, the cafe. Many regions of the auditory cortex are tonotopically arranged. This means that specific neurons are better at processing specific frequencies. The primary auditory cortex is tonotopically arranged in a V shape, with higher frequencies processed on the medial side of the cortex and lower frequencies processed on the lateral side. There's emerging research that there may exist other forms of maps on the auditory cortex as well, for loudness and for spatial location. You now have a conscious perception of sound that exists in your brain. But sound is not all there is to music. In order for you to understand sound and perceive it as music, the auditory signal must travel to other areas of your brain. The auditory cortex is connected via white matter pathways to areas all over your brain. These pathways form the network that we call the auditory system, or the sound mind. The auditory signal travels through these pathways, being further processed at each stop along the way. These are not one-way streets. The signals flow back and forth through different areas of the brain, to and from the auditory cortex, and even back towards the ear. Different stops in the network are more specialized for processing different elements of music. For example, processing intervals, melody, and harmony involves superior temporal and inferior frontal regions bilaterally. Rhythm is processed in a network that involves motor areas, the basal ganglia, and the cerebellum. Understanding the meaning, syntax, and structure of music involves pathways that overlap with those used in language processing. Areas involved include frontal and temporal regions, as well as the white matter pathways that connect them. Our experience of music is shaped by what we see and how we move. Think about why music videos are so popular. They involve visual stimulus and often some form of dance. Integration of sound with your visual field and motor sensation happens in association areas of your parietal lobe. Keeping track of all of these elements simultaneously involves attention and working memory areas of your frontal lobe, specifically the prefrontal cortex and inferior frontal areas. The two sides of your brain are not equals when it comes to music processing. In most people, the right side of your brain is better suited for pitch, melody, and harmony processing, while the left side of your brain is better at speech and language processing. It is important, however, to know that both sides of your brain are active and involved in music processing. All of these processes running simultaneously produce your perception of music. Is this all there is to it? Far from it. Music is a powerful and mysterious art form, not just because of its physical and auditory characteristics, but because of the way it makes you feel. Let's take a look at how music affects us socially and emotionally. Your emotions are governed by your limbic system, a collection of structures deep inside your brain. These structures include your amygdala, basal ganglia, hypothalamus, and hippocampus, among other structures, each of which has its own role in processing the emotional response that we feel. The auditory network has direct connections to the limbic system. This can help explain why we feel visceral emotional reactions to music. Intense euphoria, chills, or disgust, for example. These emotions are accompanied by measurable physical reactions, changes in heart rate, skin temperature, or goosebumps, to name a few. The limbic system is also involved in the formation and retrieval of long-term memories. This may be why music is so good at evoking nostalgia or bringing up forgotten memories. Music plays an emotional role in the way we groove to music and also activates your reward system, the system of motivation and pleasure regulated by the chemical messenger dopamine. When you listen to music with a drop, your brain floods with dopamine, not only during the drop, but also during the buildup. The anticipation and resulting release of tension both contribute to your sense of emotional reward. Music also plays a vital role in our social bonding and cohesion. In a recent survey of 100 students at the University of Michigan, over 85% of participants reported regularly listening to music at parties or social gatherings. We connect to one another through music. There's a rhythmic component to this social effect. A study looked at two groups of babies, one of which was bounced in sync with the researcher, the other group was bounced out of sync. The researchers tested the baby's social behavior by dropping a pen. It turns out, the group that had been bounced in sync with the researcher were more likely to help the researcher pick up the pen. They formed stronger social bonds. We synchronize or rhythmically entrain to one another through our speech, our behavior, and through music. And being in sync is how we bond. This entire process, from a vibration in the air to music in your mind, only takes a few milliseconds, and it happens with no conscious effort. So what is the point of understanding how music is processed in our brains? Well, for a musician, understanding how music works in your brain can help you create better music. You can better understand the effect that your music has on your audience. For the music lover, this knowledge can help you better understand yourself, why you feel the way you do when you listen to your favorite songs. There's a benefit for society as well. Music has been used as medicine for thousands of years. It's about time we figured out how it works. If you'd like to join me on this journey, make sure to subscribe to my channel. If you felt like you learned something new, leave a like. Any questions, leave them in the comment section below. If you're interested in learning more about how individual aspects of music are processed in your brain, check out this playlist here. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time on Neuroscience for Musicians.